Mm-hmm. times in spiritual reality. With cotton and blood. Pizza Hut family.
We'll be right back. You breathe like rats, and you're no fucking better. Too many fucking humans. You breathe like rats, and you're no fucking better. Too many fucking humans. You breathe like rats, and you're no fucking better.
Yeah! Thank you. Occasionally the sky would weep upon us, gently moistening my shoes with its veil of tears. None minded these random displays of emotion, for the tears were those of joy, not sorrow. Animals lay quite still in their inhabitants, the water softly gathering in their coats, replenishing dried oils and lost ointments, replacing that what had grown dry and stale in fur and feathers, what was rich and new. All were happy to share this lushness. Tiny insects would sleep without fear. On the eyelashes of larger beasts, snakes and lizards could rest in the shade provided by a lumbering hippo's smooth round stomach. Microscopic termites and bugs could create temporary cities in the folds of coarse, sun-cracked skin that enveloped mirrored hooves and claws. In short, this was a world of concession, of sharing, of brotherhood. These were also special in other ways, each one hung like a crystal, rotating slowly, gathering speed, before eventually snapping off to begin its short descent to the ground. At once, rest, they would coagulate like ice and become sharp and chiseled in appearance, before eventually, metamorphosis gave way to a smooth, multi-domed finish that was opaque like quartz. These diminutive formations hung motionless, undisturbed, sometimes for centuries, locked away in deep excavations, isolations. They learned the other and caves growing, multiplying in their solitude. As they experienced this isolation, they learned other skills. The creation and amplification of pitch, each nurturing its own tiny voice, until in time, a choral correlation was formed. Their sound was unlike anything heard previously, and was, it had been noted, heard infrequently due in main to the location of their concerts. Folklore is rich with tales of how miners and potholers trapped miles underground thought they heard the voices of heard angels' voices calling out to them from the black recesses of the rock. Their song would act as homing beacons for all that the wayward traveller would have to do would be follow the direction of sound, until eventually it led back to a familiar point and out of Worm's way. Until the existence of these crystal tears was known, few doubted the incredible stories of these men, few of whom, it must be said, could coherently describe the uniqueness and beauty of the tones they had heard. This was, after all, a very different world from the one we inhabit today. Dragons and goblins were still seen roaming the valleys and grassy dales. Magic was both respected and feared. The evolution of science had progressed no further than the practices of wizards and alchemists. Clearly these caves and earthly openings were not as abundant in the cities and built up in industrial areas as they were in less populated territories. The sonic isle of green meadows reverberated with chimes from the earth's core, acting as some space-age mantra, a coded orchestra spanning the infinities of time and space. Perhaps we, the humans, serve only as conductors of this sound, allowing it to pass through us, interact with our bodies, and leave away, and leave again, heavy with goodness. There is a strain of thought that aspires to the notion of wizards and magicians still very much alive today, still working amongst us, only in a conventional sense, the stereotypical image of high hats and gown, of fantastic beard housing squawky ravens and whispering owls, hung leather-bound books. Huge leather-bound books, heavy with runes and complicated spells, had been disbanded. Today's warlocks and spellcasters wear denims and cotton shirts, and are in all probability clean-shaven.